anatomy, cardiovascular system. In this video, we are going to study the structure of the heart by analyzing the layers of its wall and try to understand its function. From the innermost to the outermost, the layers are named endocardium, myocardium, and epicardium. The endocardium serves as an internal protection, and the epicardium as an external protection. The myocardium instead is a muscle tissue, the pulsating heart of the heart. The endocardium is a very thin tissue that is only 50 to 200 microns thick. This means that its maximum thickness is approximately equal to 1.5 millimeters. The endocardium itself is composed of three sublayers. The superficial layer is an endothelial layer. The endothelial cells, which we all know very well, are capable of a great number of exchanges where the blood comes into contact with them. Nonetheless, the endothelial cells are very thin, and the nucleus is the sole bulge on their surface. Then there is a thin layer of smooth muscle cells and a dense connective tissue that is the lamina propria. And finally, there is a layer of connective tissue, the subendocardial layer. In the subendocardial layer, there are small vessels, the marginal branches of the coronary arteries, and the small nervous fibers, also called the Purkinje fibers. The Purkinje fibers are the marginal branches of the cardiac conduction system. And here is the endocardium in real life. As you can see, it is whitish and translucent. Moreover, even though it is not so visible here, the endocardium goes on, covers most of the initial part of the arteries, and thereby becomes the endothelium. From the microscopic point of view, this little layer is very thin on the left, so thin that it is only visible at its nucleus. But let's talk about the myocardium now. The myocardium can be divided in two types of tissues, the working myocardium, its pulsating part, and the specialized myocardium, its conduction and transmission system. We have already talked about the specialized myocardium in the video regarding the conduction system of the heart. Instead, in this video, we are going to conduct a cytological analysis of the myocardium. So, let's start by talking about the working myocardium. The working myocardium is made up of big cells, not as big as those of the striated muscles, but not even as small as the smooth one. So let's say that they are somewhere in between 20 microns thick and 100 microns wide, with one nucleus in a central position and some striatons. These cells have a rich sarcoplasmatic reticulum, or SR, made up of actin and myosin myofilaments that, by flowing on one another, cause the contraction. A peculiar characteristic of the myocardium is the presence around each cell of a rich capillary branching that ensures the adequate amount of oxygen to each myocardiocyte. In this way, the myocardiocytes, the number one users of the aerobic respiration, are provided with a great amount of oxygen needed in any moment. The myocardiocytes are then connected to each other by the intercalated discs, identifying features of the cardiac muscle with a staircase-like structure. On the vertical part of these striae, we can see desmosome-like junctions. Located on the longitudinal ends of the cardiomyocyte, the intercalated discs allow the junction the maximum resistance to traction. Instead, on the horizontal axis, we can see the gap junctions, channels that, by facilitating the communication, allow the myocardial cells to react as one big syncytium, also called functional syncytium. The myocardium is also characterized by The sarcolemma, consisting of beta-adrenergic receptors that are stimulated by the sympathetic nervous system, or SNS, the mitochondria in a very large number due to the highly oxidative metabolism of the heart, and finally, the already mentioned myofibrils, whose structure can be compared to that of the striated muscle. So, since we've already talked about the myocardiocyte ultrastructure, we can now have a look at some of its functions. First, let's say that the myocardiocyte is not like the striated muscle, whose action potential is very simple and lasts only for 2 milliseconds, but it is an excitable cell with a very particular system. Here, the action potentials are very long and last for up to 200 milliseconds. This is possible thanks to particular interactions of the ion channels. But let's see what happens. The myocardiocyte has a resting potential of minus 70 millivolt. However, when stimulated, the membrane potential of the myocardiocyte increases all the way up to plus 10 millivolt. And this is due to the opening of the sodium channels that enter the cell, making it positive. Then, as in the muscle cell, the potassium channel starts to open up, letting the potassium come out from the cell, thus making it more negative. But here's the difference. These channels are rather slow. Then, in the so-called plateau phase, together with the potassium channels, which favor the flow of potassium and the negative charge of the cell, the calcium channels open, which favors the inflow of calcium and therefore the positive charge of the cell. The result is that for a certain period of time, the cell potential doesn't change and there is a plateau phase. In the end, only the potassium channels will remain open. The calcium channels will close and a slope will restore the standard level. Actually, there is a phase of hyperpolarization beforehand and a restoration due to the sodium-potassium pump. Well, another curious thing of the common myocardium is that its tissue has some areas with special functions, among which the most studied ones, the auricles, anatomically identified as parts, projections of the atria. The endocrine activity of the auricles is peculiar due to its myocardiocytes that are not only contractile, but also secretory cells that release the so-called natriuretic peptide, a substance that favors sodium extraction, thus increasing the urine volume. In fact, this substance is released during the relaxation of the heart, caused by the large quantity of blood inflow. The relaxation is, therefore, perceived by the auricles of the myocardiocytes that produce the substance, acting at the same time as sensor and as a response. Now, let's have a look at the appearance of the myocardium. It is a reddish tissue, and in some parts, very thick. Under the microscope, the cells seem rather eosinophilic, slightly striated, especially in the central nucleus. As you can see, there is a massive presence of capillaries between a cell and another. By magnifying the image, the striations become simpler to be observed, as all the capillaries can be seen in the longitudinal cut section. The further magnification of the image shows the position of the nuclei and the striation becomes clearly visible. But let's talk about the specialized myocardium now. The specialized myocardium is composed of a series of cells that create and conduct the impulse. The B cells, or pacemaker cells, about which we talked in the previous video, are fusiform and can be found in the nodes. Located in the periphery of the nodes, the features of the T cells or transitional cells are similar to those of the myocardiocytes. The transitional cells are in fact elongated and do have myofilaments, although not enough for observing its radiance under the optical microscope. Lastly, at the bundle branch, we can see the wide network of the Purkinje cells ending the cardiac conduction system. And here's the Purkinje cells under the microscope. On the lower right, we can see a bundle made up of all these elements, while here we can see the Purkinje cells branching off in the muscle cells and then their big nucleus. Finally, let's talk about the epicardium, the outermost layer of the heart. The epicardium is a tissue made up of different layers. The first and most superficial one is the mesothelium, that is 50 to 200 microns thick, as in the endocardium. Although apparently similar, mesothelium and endocardium have slightly different functions. Then there is a layer of adipose tissue, very thin. And finally, there is the subepicardial layer with a larger coronary branches. Since the epicardium is translucent and transparent, it is almost invisible from the macroscopic point of view, as you can see here. While under the microscope, as you can see here, we can clearly see the superficial layer, the adipose layer, and all the various vessels.
Thank you for watching. This video was created by School of Biomedical Sciences, Agorà. We hope you enjoyed it. If you're curious or have any doubt or question, please feel free to leave a comment below. If you want to find out more about us or want to support our project, click on the following link to visit our website. Thank you for watching. This video was created by School